From Chicago, Kup's Show with Irv Kupcinet.
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another hour of the lively art of conversation, all extemporaneous, all unrehearsed, and all spontaneous. Our panel tonight consists of three outstanding authorities on world and national affairs, and each with a very significant story, and I'm sure you're going to find this a fascinating 60 minutes. I'd like you to meet the panel now. First, the very famous Oriana Fallaci, one of the most brilliant and controversial interviewers of our time. She's written a novel about her relationship with a Greek resistance fighter named Alexos Panagoulis. A relationship that began with an interview and lasted for three turbulent years until his death. The book is entitled Simply a Man. And this is Victor Navasky, right? Okay. He also is a tremendously famous and tremendous reporter, I should say, editor of The Nation, and he has made a significant study of blacklisting and the McCarthy era in his book called Naming Names. And Bertram Gross, professor of political science and a former White House aide to Presidents Roosevelt and Truman. And he warns of a new style despotism that is creeping around across the United States in his book called Friendly Fascism. Welcome one and all. And Ariano, it's so nice to have you back here in Chicago as a guest on the show once again. Every time you've been here, you have been very exciting and very fascinating, and we're delighted you could make it again.
Thank you. I was writing the book when I came here the last time.
Yes, we talked about the possibility of this book coming out and the great love story. Before we get into the love story, let me ask you something.
It's much more than that. The book is not the story of my relationship with Alekos. It's much more than that.
It's a great human story, a great love story, and a great political story too.
Overalls, and also a love story.
Before we get into that book, though, Oriana, let me ask you about some of the famous people you have interviewed and your impressions of them today.
Oh, you don't want to go into that. That's old news. Come on, that belongs to the far past.
A lot of people
past.
Are interested in, for instance, what do you think of the Ayatollah Khomeini today? Any difference than when you interviewed him?
You really want to talk about that? That's pitiless. I'm here to talk about my book.
We'll get into that. We got a lot of time, but we'd like to get some of your other impressions, too.
Well, it's 1 year that I saw him, Lena, is it?
Yeah.
I saw him a month before the kidnapping of the hostages, the taking of the embassy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the impression I had among the others was that, unfortunately, he was far from being only a fool, as you believe here. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's rather intelligent. He knows what he's doing. I do not know if today he has the country in his hands as he seemed to have it on October, was it 79?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yeah, when I was there. My impression is that he has lost part of his authority and he tries to balance among the various groups in an intelligent way, though, using both of them and sometimes putting them one against the other, you know, according to the old rule, divide and impair.
And conquer.
That I guess he never read it anywhere, but it comes spontaneously. There is this kind of spontaneous, primitive wisdom, believe it or not.
The thing that stood out in my mind in that interview, as well as the important things, was the fact that you took off the chador, the long Islamic gown that women have to wear, and you told them how ridiculous this is to have to.
I knew you would go back to that also. It's inevitable. It's a curse, is it? Huh? Yeah. I said, I'm going to be there to speak about the book. You bet he will ask me about Khomeini and the chador. Yes, I took it off because I was offended. And where did I put it in? Oh, I have it. I was offended. He had said something very rude. He had said I was speaking about the chador. But of course, I was not speaking of an injument, of a piece of tissue. I was speaking of what the chador meant, lack of freedom. Another form of fascism.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about. And he did, he was somehow very smart because he had not much to answer to what I was saying to him, besides the very truth. And he said then, well, if you don't like the chador, you shouldn't wear it. Chador is for young, proper women. At that point, I burst. I exploded. I didn't throw it. I just slipped it away. I took it off. And something which offended him in return very much. In fact, he got up and went away immediately. He stopped being looking that very old, very dignified, very sick, that he can't move. And he got up as a young cat and left me. And left me, and I remained there for a couple of hours, saying that I wouldn't move if he wouldn't come back, or if he wouldn't swear on the Quran that he would see me again. Neither they could touch me, because, you know, they cannot put, according to their religion, their hands on a woman. And then finally, after 2 hours, the Hamed, the son, came back and said, if you see him again tomorrow at 5, will you get up and go? I said, swear on the Quran. He went to ask the father if he could swear on the Quran. Then he came back and said, okay. So I saw him again, and everybody was telling me, please don't talk about the chador again. Don't make him angry again. And instead, I did what you are now doing with me, going back with Khomeini, and I don't want to speak about Khomeini. And I said, let's begin again where we stopped today. And he smiled. He was very amused. It was the only moment in which I saw this man smile with sympathy and with respect, which means that he had, my impression was that he respect force, because I had made an act of force on him. But you don't go on too much on this act of force of me, eh? You don't go on too much speaking about Khomeini.
No, now, okay. No, we're through with Khomeini now. What about the Shah? Did you see any resemblance between those two?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Both strong,
Both fanatic. At a certain extent, speaking the same language. Both fascist.
What about Gaddafi of Libya? Now, you got three men who are practically all fanatics.
That's garbage.
He's garbage.
Yes. He's fool. I think Gaddafi is clinically fool. That was my impression. I mean, if you listen to the tape of that interview, at a certain moment you have the exact impression that there is something really unbalanced in him. Repeating words as a broken record, you know, I'm the gospel, I'm the gospel, I'm the gospel. Kind of scaring, in a way.
Well, you've interviewed so many famous people, Oriana, but only one you really fell in love with? Is that the only one?
Of course.
Alekos is the only one you really fell in love with.
Oh, God. Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. But you see, that was not, I didn't need to interview Aleko to love Aleko. I mean, he was so famous, you know, in Europe. I mean, in the part of the world where I belong to. He was, since years, the symbol of freedom, the symbol of resistance. Here in America,
he was a symbol
he's
of
not
freedom
much
in Greece.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You have no idea what happened in Europe on October, November, in the fall of 68, when he was condemned to death by the martial court. Mm-hmm. I mean, in Rome and Paris and Bonn and London, in Zurich, everywhere, the enormous rallies, thousands and thousands of people in the streets, clashing and fighting with the police, the windows of the Greek embassy smashed, arrest, Molotov bottle. It was unbelievable. And besides, you know, the reason why he was not executed, it was the intervention of all the world, all the heads of state, everybody intervened to spare his life. From I don't know, the Queen of England to Brezhnev to Johnson, Utant, the Pope, Paul VI, and it helped very much the intervention of Johnson, because of course Papadopoulos wouldn't do something that that the Americans did not want, especially in that moment with all the NATO problems, etc. They did not need a martyr, you know, an execution. And that's why they didn't execute him then. But the death penalty was just suspended, not canceled. And in fact, Alekos used to tell me that according to the law, their law, for 3 years, they could have executed him every day. And every morning that they went to him to wake him up too early, he was afraid they would come to pick him up.
This
and
was
to
a
drive
form of torture,
execution.
Wasn't it? They let him think he was
going to
be executed every day.
Oh, there was more than that. Because, you know, soon after the arrest, also this we knew very well in Europe, there was much writing about it. Soon after the arrest, this man was physically tortured in the most savage way. When I met him, he was limping a little because the left foot, for instance, just to say one thing, the left foot had been beaten with the a torture they call the falanga under the foot. At that point that the bones had been broken. Mm. He was limping. The wrist, because they used to make him, to hang him to the ceiling. You know, he was hanging to the ceiling when they were torturing him, and they were all ruined, and he was kind of self-conscious about the left wrist, and he was all the time covering this. One day I went to the doctor with him to have some x-ray, he wasn't well, and the doctor, after doing the x-ray, said, "My God, this man doesn't have one single bone which is intact." Then add to this all the moral tortures. And the same thing in that cell. He used to tell me about this cell, and of course I believed him, but I didn't think it was that bad. And after his death, I could finally get the permission to go and see it, the cell which they had built just for him in the military prison of Boyati. And they had never permitted him to see it again, not even after the democracy had been reestablished and the friendly fascism had not permitted him to see it again. And after his death, Karamanlis finally gave me the permission, and when I saw it, I didn't believe it. It was as large as this table. No window. Uh-huh. No air, nothing, you see? And it was fantastic. It takes a lot of faith, a lot of courage, a lot of strength to survive that.
It impressed me very much that Alekos, after all these years of militant action against the fascists, decided to work within the frame of government instead of outside the frame. And he changed, as you point out in the book. He wanted to run for office, wanted to work within the system to make the changes, as we advocate in this country, rather than outside the system.
That was his great, in my opinion, a great step he did. At a certain moment to understand, and he did understand that before the fall of the junta, that is of the military mm-hmm. dictatorship, that the struggle had not to be conducted with the violence. It wouldn't change anything. It would if the whole people would participate, if the whole people of the whole country would go into the resistance as we had gone in Europe under the Nazi fascism. But a few wouldn't achieve much. So the struggle had to be conducted through political tools. And it is because of this that he accepted, when he returned to his country after the fall of the dictatorship, to participate in the elections and to be elected. But once he was in parliament, he was the same Alekos of always, I mean, the same poet, the same hero, the same individuals who struggles alone against everybody, not followed by anybody. At a certain point that he soon realized how desperate it was for him to stay in what I call in the book, the politics of the politicians. He couldn't stay in it. And he finally did this final challenge, that is what I call his personal Watergate. He went searching for documents that would demonstrate that the people now in power were the heirs of the military dictatorship, or they had been cooperating with the military dictatorship, and they were new fascists, friendly fascists, I go back to your book. At that point, though, and that was the last heroic act of his life, he was no less hero in those days than he had been under the resistance, because nobody wanted those documents. Nobody wanted to publish. There was not one paper that accepted to publish them, except one that they finally tried very timidly. They started only a couple of days, they printed something, but the parts which were not important, they did not accuse anybody. And this gave time to the people in power, to the government, to the Minister of the Defense, Averov, to call the magistrates to stop the publication. And then, and I am at the conclusion of the story, he decided the only thing that could be done, that is to give these documents in parliament to Karamanlis, against whom there was nothing in this document. At that point, he had found nothing against Karamanlis. And he asked, it would be very solemn, very dramatic moment. I mean, he would get up and he would go to Karamanlis, who would be in parliament that day, mm-hmm. and he would give the documents in front of everybody. In my opinion, he committed the mistake of telling it. He called for a press conference. He told everybody he would do that. He would do that on Monday, the 3rd of May. It was a Monday morning. And he was killed the night between Friday and Saturday, automobile accident. It was not an accident. It was a phony accident. It is not true that the car were two cars. The car was one. The car were two. There were four witnesses that saw it. What remained of the car of Alekos after the crash has been examined by a commission of Italian experts, and they found traces of color paint of the other car, which was a red car. No doubt it was an assassination, political assassination. Mm-hmm. Now they can say for compromise or because it is comfortable what they want. Each of them, it was a political assassination. Everybody knows it.
Your fight against fascism down through the years should interest you in Mr. Gross's book. And you say that you have great confidence in the future of this country as a democratic entity, but the immediate future you're concerned about, because you do see signs of fascism arising in our country.
I do, but I don't want to talk about my book. My book is out of date. When I sent it to the printer in January, I didn't predict that the Ku Klux Klan would be burning crosses in my city, or that the KKK would be winning nominations in the Democratic and Republican primaries, or that black children would be abducted on a large scale, or that black men would be killed with their hearts cut out in the city of Buffalo, or that a court, a jury, would find Ku Kluxers unguilty even after it was shown that they shot down four white men and one black.
You're saying your book is out of date already? That's not a very good way of selling it, Bertram.
No, it isn't. It isn't. But I thought things would move very slowly. Maybe they will still move slowly, but in a sense, what I tried to capture was a drift toward a highly manipulative and repressive corporate state. I spent 10 years writing the book and had to do a lot of rewriting. I wrote about Greece. When Papadopoulos was there, I figured out that I'm putting this to you here, and it's a little oversimplified, that if TV narcotization, if the TV addiction could be spread around Greece, that the junta could be replaced by a fellow like Karamanlis. And that was written in my chapter. Then I had to rewrite it because by the time I finished the manuscript, Karamanlis was in. And I checked with a friend of mine from Greece, and I read him the manuscript. I had said, by the time the TV is introduced in all the bars of Athens, they won't need the bloody dictator. They can manipulate the minds of the Greek people. And he said, well, you're all wrong. By the time that happened, TV and Kojak and I Love Lucy was in every coffee house in every village throughout the entire country. And which shows that, you know, in a sense, what happened in Greece was a little hopeful. I always prefer a lesser evil if it's really lesser and isn't counterbalanced by some greater evil around the corner that you don't see. So I think, you know, the Greek experience proves that bloody fascism is resistible and can be changed.
You say, though, that you have great hope for democracy in the long run, although maybe in the short run we'll have a rough period. Will you explain why you feel in the long run we will have democracy, perhaps in the short run we will have a...
Well, even in the in the drug addiction of TV, we have shows like this, in which people can freely express their views. And in America particularly, there is a democratic vitality, which is often repressed and comes out in a very in a scattered way, but it's really there. It's really there. And there's a sense in which repression creates a reaction. So I think that people may be awakened by what they see. What are we getting under Ronald Reagan? We're getting bigger government in the name of smaller government. Bigger government because it's going to be upping defense expenditures, going ahead on some kind of new missile, whether it's in submarines or racetracks or fixed positions, going ahead on the B-1 bomber, on the neutron bomb. All these things are immensely expensive, and it means higher taxes. He'll go the way of Thatcher, reducing taxes on the upper middle class, income taxes in the upper middle class, and coming in with a sales tax by 1982. With or without that, we're getting more inflation and more unemployment. And
Those are graver dangers, I think. Mm-hmm. More inflation and more unemployment are the grave dangers to a democracy.
This is the crucial thing.
This is where people get so upset that they welcome any kind of relief, and the relief may be the guy on the white horse who turns the country around.
Well, I think the big danger in America, as in England and Italy and France and Japan and West Germany, is not the gangster-type fascists. The big danger is not the fascism from below. It's the fascism coming down from above, right from the middle-of-the-road extremists.
Even voted in.
Possibly. Voted in, but with majority of the people saying they can't vote for those characters anyway. Yeah. I mean, let's not kid ourselves. That was not a landslide. You can have a landslide in the Electoral College with only 1,000 people voting.
Yeah, this was not a landslide as far as the popular vote.
It was no landslide at all. He only got 26.7 of the electoral votes, which means almost 3/4 of the population voted for someone else that didn't vote at all. But the key thing that this was rampant apathy. Now that apathy is promoted by the people at the top who say, lower your aspirations, don't expect too much, and we have a big danger out there. Big danger out there, the Bolshevik menace.
Let me ask Victor and Oriana how they feel about the possibility of problems along these lines coming in with the Ronald Reagan administration.
Don't say problems, say friendly fascism.
Well, it may not go that far, but...
you ask a question.
The Heritage Foundation in Philadelphia has recently finished a 3,000-page report.
Horrendous.
In nine volumes, which is reported to recommend, among other things, the reestablishment of the House Committee on Un-American Activities, wider spreading of the loyalty oath, which is still in place in many places, the reinstitution. They say explicitly that when national safety is in contest with individual rights and liberties, obviously national safety has to come first, and that means wiretapping, mail covers, illegal entries, so that it is the brief for instituting, codifying, legitimizing all of the excesses that the so-called paranoid left had claimed was going on throughout the 60s, and we know they were.
One thing you left out was the end of affirmative action.
And the end of affirmative action,
except
for informers, which they have recommended the more widespread use of informers in organizations, including explicitly anti-nuclear organizations and anti-draft organizations.
Yeah. But let's not pin this on the Reagan administration,
because
there's no indication.
But let's say this, that one of their advisors was Mr. Mies, who was the head of the Reagan transition. Now, look at Reagan's role during the 50s. He was friendly, and he wasn't more evil than anyone else who went along with the whole Hollywood blacklist situation. He was head of the Screen Actors Guild at the time.
You're going way back now.
I'm going way back to the time when he was a trade union leader, and I believe at that time, if the trade union leadership had resisted the blacklist, which covered the whole industry that he was part of, it couldn't happen in the way it did. And when one of his members came forward and went to him and said, Mr. Reagan, it was Gail Sondergaard, who played the Spider-Woman and was married to one of the Hollywood Ten, came forward and asked him to protest the issuing of a subpoena to her by the Un-American Activities Committee as a witch hunt subpoena, He wrote back in the name of the guild that he was president of that while he personally was against any secret blacklist, if she was so politically controversial that she cost sales at the box office, he could do nothing and the guild should do nothing to protect her. He then made a recommendation to the Motion Picture Industry Council that they collect dossiers on everybody in Hollywood and use that central data bank as a repository so that when people were accused by the Un-American Activities Committee of subversive activities, they could check this against the data bank. Well, those impulses, to me, are not reassuring as one looks ahead and tries to figure out what kind of president he's going to be.
Let me ask Oriana, what kind of feelings and vibes do you get about Mr. Reagan as president?
Listen, I wouldn't like to go into this particular, besides I do not have this particular knowledge of the fact of the American things, but I would like to say something which I feel it's as much important. Let's try to say it so. There is a scene in my book, which is a scene that reproducts something that really happened, that I really saw. When Alekos was released, after he had been released by the jail, Papadopoulos was still in power, and the military junta was there. And there is a moment in which he cries, tears fall on his face, and he looks at the Acropolis and he says, a bad democracy, but a democracy. An evil democracy, but a democracy. A dirty democracy, but a democracy. But democracy better than what we have now. And we should never forget this, that it is very bitter to say, but it is better a bad democracy than no democracy at all. Okay, once we have said to this, we have to consider the however, the but, because we are kind of pompous, we who belong to more or less democratic country when we pronounce democracy. And we forget too often how little democratic democracy is, as you, the two of you know very well. The another danger that is there, and more than a danger, is a fact that risks to become, to be worsened. It is not only the friendly fascism of the democracy in the country where the democracy exists. It is the protection of the real, clear fascism, the fascist regime, that the democracy exercises abroad, beyond its frontier. I mean, let us not forget that the American democracy has protected regimes like Greece, Spain, Portugal, Chile, Argentina, Bolivia, all the military dictatorships, for instance, in Latin America.
El Salvador today.
And this is a danger that, more than a danger, I said, a fact that has belongs to our history, recent and, let's say, also present, that might become worse. I'm very concerned about that, about these democracies which protect the fascist regimes.
Bertram, along those same lines, in your book you are very heavy-handed in hitting out at the military-industrial complex, and could you explain more what you mean by the dangers inherent therein?
Well, the least of the dangers is that the huge expansion programs that they're planning for, and I mentioned some of them before, from the restoration of anti-ballistic missiles and the B-1 bomber and the neutron bomb and the chemical binary chemical bombs and all that, the least of the dangers is inflation. They're very inflationary. And the burden will be put on the middle and the lower income groups with the conflicts between the lower and middle income groups as to who carries a big burden. The biggest danger, of course, is this false machismo of calling, of saying that this has something to do with the safety of the country. It's quite the reverse. The attitude that instead of negotiating with those Russians, or instead of lifting up the possibilities of true democracy, or a little democracy in Central America, whether you're talking about El Salvador, Guatemala, or Nicaragua. The danger is that the response to this is we're going to have an arms race in which the United States government is going to officially say, unless you Russians behave, we will commit suicide. And that's what it means. You know, Teddy Roosevelt said, carry a big stick.
You may be misinterpreting what he says or putting your own...
Oh, I'm putting my interpretation. I'm saying that nuclear, there's no such thing.
He has said that we will sit down with the Russians and sit down as long as it takes to operate and negotiate a new SALT II agreement.
That's correct, and I'm for that very much. I would like to think that the détente can be restored. But if it's to be restored, it can't be purely bilateral. It has to include the Warsaw Pact and all the NATO countries. And beyond that, I would like to think that could happen. However, there is no basis for raising that military budget if détente comes back, because détente means a decline in this atmosphere of confrontation. And when you have that decline, the military spending goes down and the military-industrial complex loses its free lunch. It loses its subsidies. So. Reagan is caught in a big contradiction here. Some of his people want to make money by doing business with the Russians. They can't make money by doing business with the Russians if you have to have an atmosphere of confrontation to justify their getting these big handouts through defense contracts. But the business about, George Bush said during the campaign, the United States of America is strong enough to win a third world war. There's no victory in a third world war. This is nonsense. The threat that we're going to use it. It says that the right, we shall abolish the right to life for most of the living in the United States.
You know, Bush got into a discussion with Robert Scheer of the Los Angeles Times on how you win a third world war, and he talked about the difference between how many millions of people you could save using this kind of nuclear weapon versus that kind of nuclear weapon. And it was right out of Dr. Strangelove. Of course, Reagan in the campaign did come out for the arms race as a way of dealing with the Russians, whatever he's saying now. And one hopes that that with the office, the man will realize its limitations.
Yeah, but let us not forget that the others don't do any better.
That's right.
Because the Russians are increasing their armaments at the speed that we all know. And we Europeans know very well, because we are caught in the middle. And both of you, Americans and Russians, want us to accept your damn nuclear weapons. No. And I don't know, it seems that in Eastern Europe they cannot do much to refuse them. In Western Europe, we can a little more, not that much. And, you know, when we speak of Third World War, let us not forget that the first to go, it's the European, it's us,
and
it's not you.
And that's the case for détente, though. Yeah. You have made seconded Bertram's case for détente.
Listen. I can't speak for all my friends. I don't know about Victor or even Oriana. But if Ronald Reagan should shift in midstream, if he should shift and go for détente, even though he knows that with a new détente, which would reduce arms spending, there'll be less money for the military-industrial complex and all his friends in it. If he should go for that, I prefer that to the Carter administration.
Certainly. You're talking about fighting inflation. That would be one major step in fighting inflation, as well as bringing some sense back to our nation. What the hell is the purpose of all these nuclear weapons? And we have enough now to destroy the whole world.
I'm an old-time New Dealer. I can't get over my liberal instincts, but if a conservative administration, I think it's improbable, but I'm for it. If a conservative administration could move into the kind of détente that Helmut Schmidt and Giscard d'Estaing perhaps both want, then I think that's the most important thing in this country.
You've seen it 1,000 times, where the candidates speak one way. When they get into office, they usually go toward the middle, because that's where the votes are and that's where the people
But I think the great danger is, if Reagan does go towards the middle, that 4 years from now, he won't have solved the problems of stagflation with his program of getting the government off our backs. And he's not going to cut military spending significantly. And 4 years from now, it seems to me, the question is the choice going to be, when people are disillusioned with the Reagan administration, is the choice going to be a Republican Party, Reagan's going to be too old to run for office again, versus a Teddy Kennedy or a warmed-over New Deal Democrat? Or is it going to be choice between Reagan-centrist Republican?
I know, but to get somebody else in there.
But
too.
Is the real choice going to be a Bush versus something much further to the right within the Republican Party? The moral majority then comes to power, and that's 1984, and that's, I think, where the comeuppance on the Reagan presidency comes. Not this week, but 4 years
nothing,
from now.
There's nothing the Reagan administration can really do with their inclinations to pour the money into more free lunches for the big business elements. There's nothing they can do to keep inflation from roaring back and to keep unemployment from rising. The only answer...
Why do you say there's nothing they can do, Bertram?
Because they're already committed to more military spending, which
not
is
not necessarily if they have a SALT agreement. There
well,
will be less military
well,
spending,
right.
Or at least it won't be increased.
But leaving the other side, they're already committed to more subsidies to business through the kind of tax expenditures, which are just havens and giveaways, more subsidies to business, which will themselves encourage the inflationary fires of heavy capital investments, not to put people to work, but to replace labor. Remember, the term productivity, as defined in America, means replacing labor with machines and really with robots.
I think, I think it's very optimistic to think that Reagan is going to move towards détente. He still operates with the 1950 Cold War images of what the Soviets and communism is all about. He still talks about godless communism. I talked to one fellow who was a movie writer who went to work for the General Electric Theater at the time that Reagan was running the General Electric Theater in the early 50s, and he told me that Reagan asked him to write a scene into a screenplay that he had done in which it showed a communist mother slapping her child because she caught him praying. The writer said he refused to do it, and they insisted on putting it in, so he took his name off the script. But that's the man who's going to be sitting in the White House now.
It's improbable.
Yeah, but don't you think that the danger of a third war goes beyond one a president or another one? I don't think you can say
but they make
with
a
this
difference.
President
sure.
it's easier it's, or it is more difficult. I would buy, I always try to control my passions, and God knows how much of them I have. I try to rationalize things and to be cold, especially on this issue. And I heard on ABC there was an interview, Ted Koppel interview, that Soviet one of the heads of the Soviet radio and TV in Moscow. And he said a very interesting thing that I would partially share. He said that very often candidates to presidency in America who introduced themselves as liberals turned out to be more conservative than what they had promised in their phony promises. And other times, presidents that had introduced themselves as very conservative turn out to be more liberal than the one that it was expected. So we don't know what's going to happen. When Carter was elected, people asked me when I was on TV, what do you think about Carter? I said, nothing, let me see what he does. Now I would try to force myself to say the same thing. Let's see what he does. The danger is not in one president. It is with this going on in increasing the weapons. I mean, I think that Wojtyla, I call him Wojtyla, I'm not religious, the new pope, is right when he says sooner or later you will use all those weapons. And I think that Deng Xiaoping, when I interviewed him last August, was right when he said all those weapons which are must, he was speaking of the Soviet Union because you know how, of course, anti-Soviet he is. He said they are massing nuclear bombs and nuclear weapons, and they are not food that will deteriorate. They are not dresses that will deteriorate or you will use. They are going to stay good, and sooner or later they will use it. And we know what are the dangers, because the war can explode for a mistake or for a moment of lack of wisdom. And since there is the Afghanistan thing, because you all speak about inflation, etc., but the word Afghanistan has not been mentioned as yet in this discussion. It seems to me that the danger is there. There are also some, which is interesting in a way, some who believe that Afghanistan paradoxically has served to preserve peace, that the Russians have put themselves, like the American in Vietnam, in such a situation that they don't know how to get how to get out of it, that this is going, that will prevent such situation to push them in another adventure. It is a possibility, but I would not discard the other, that instead they would go on with this adventure, because there is another name that we have not mentioned, the name of the country, Iran. We don't know what's going to happen there. In that chaos, anything can happen. Afghanistan is very near to Iran. We know how many Soviet troops are massed at the frontiers with Iran. So it seems to me that it goes beyond Brezhnev, it goes beyond Reagan or Carter.
You're absolutely right. It goes beyond the personalities involved, and the real danger is one of us will blow the other up. But the truth is also that we're stuck with the president is a human being. The first act of Reagan after he was elected, you know, Congress passed a law, or both houses of the Congress have passed different versions of a statute which says that the Justice Department can no longer enforce busing orders, which changes the whole nature of the attempt to desegregate our school system. And Reagan's first policy pronouncement, before he even came into the White House, said that he would welcome such a statute and he would sign such a statute at a time when Carter has to decide whether or not he's going to veto it. So if that's a signal, you know, you're absolutely right, but we're in for bad times here at home, you know, and that's where we are.
He will have to deal with all the people who voted him, and they refuse to believe that all the all the people who voted him are conservative, are nasty, they want the war. I mean, he will have to deal with reality and leave some hope.
The tendencies are toward more repression, very clearly.
You foresee that?
Oh, no question about it. And toward more militarism.
Oh,
and when Victor says he thinks it's improbable that Reagan would go for détente, I agree with him. But I'm for the improbable good things in life. That's the basis of my optimism. The abolition of slavery was very improbable. It was impossible for Thomas Jefferson. He couldn't foresee it. He could write beautiful words, but he couldn't foresee the abolition of slavery. He kept his slaves. I think détente and real disarmament is possible. Maybe we have to have a war, an accidental war, some kind of war first. But I'm for the improbable things. I'm for the improbable things. That's where the great things are in life. And
the thing that concerns me immediately is the Russian habit of testing our new presidents. Khrushchev did it to Kennedy. Brezhnev did it to our president at the time. They come to the meetings and they get very tough, overly tough, and they really test them to see how strong they are. And I just hope that Mr. Reagan can hold his own in this kind of a confrontation, which you'll have
I don't think it will be the way that way. You're reliving history. I've discussed this a little bit with some Russians, and I think it's going to be the other way around. I'm going to think they're going to feel that if they want to dampen the arms race, which is immensely destructive to them, if they want to dampen it through some SALT 2.5 or SALT 3, I think they will plan to give Reagan a psychological victory of no great significance.
And I hope you're right.
I've had that said to me. Now, I'm just guessing. I think they're smart enough. They're trying to study this carefully. And maybe if he has a psychological victory, he can tone down his ultra-militaristic supporters. I think the odds are against it, but I'm for it. And I think that the people in America on the so-called right and the so-called middle and the so-called left, and that's a horrible way of classifying people, I think that they all would go for this kind of thing. And although the general tendency is toward clamping down, toward freezing up, toward undermining almost every section of the American Constitution and the Bill of Rights, the basic amendments to the Constitution, they're all under attack today. And this is a time, I think, when we have to overcome that sectarianism we have when people ask the question, how can the left be revived? What a nonsense question. How can the left be revived? The left in America is bereft. The middle's in a muddle and the right's half wrong, but half right. Because the people on the right, who so-called right, are people who said they see this state as something they want to get off their backs. It's an instrument of repression. That, by the way, happens to be a left-wing position. But the last TV show I was on, one of the carpenters who builds the sets came and talked to me about that. Because that's what was bothering him.
But one of the
they want to get the government off their back, but they want the government to spend more money on military. So
no, he wasn't for that either.
No, he wasn't. But I'm talking about most of the right. No,
but it's not just the government. I mean,
the point that
you make in Friendly Fascism is that, for example, the media gets its clues from the government. And take the New York Times. The New York Times ran a 6 or 7 page front page series on how we're behind in our defenses prior to the election. which, as Alan Wolf has argued in The Nation, came out of the air. I mean, whether you can always find generals to argue both sides of that issue, but the decision to put that on the front page, to make that a news peg 7 days in a row, in the midst of our national political scene, was a national policy decision. It is as if the press were the fourth branch of the government. And I think one of the lessons from the 50s is you look at that period and you learn that the press really has to play the role of an outsider and not be part of that consensus.
You feel science. The press had a role
the times
in the McCarthy era?
Well, I feel that...
In the particular segment that you're talking about, the Hollywood investigation?
Well, not only the Hollywood investigations. I mean, when I went around to talk to people for naming names, I talked, for example, to Jimmy Wexler of the New York Post, who was one of the leading liberal critics of Senator McCarthy. And Wexler denounced McCarthy. He was called before the McCarthy Committee. And when Senator McCarthy and Roy Cohn asked him, have you ever been a member of the Communist Party, and who else was a member with you? He said, you do not have the right to ask that question. You're asking it to try to intimidate me, but to prevent you from winning the public relations war and calling me a Fifth Amendment communist, I'm not going to plead the Fifth Amendment. I'm going to turn over to you an envelope with the names of 60 fellow members of the Young Communist League, including Murray Kempton and other eminent journalists of the day.
Wrong or right?
Well, I think that's wrong, because what he did was, even as he denounced McCarthy, he legitimized the right of those committees to ask that question by agreeing to go along with their procedures.
Let's take the classic case that you touch on in your book, Naming Names, the case of the great playwright Mr. Miller and the great, two great playwrights, Mr. Odets. Would you explain what their opinions and their different actions in this case?
Sure. Well, Clifford Odets, who wrote Waiting for Lefty, as you know, interestingly enough, he was part of the original group theater. And there was an actor in the group theater named J. Edward Bromberg who died of a heart attack after he appeared before the Un-American Activities Committee. He took the Fifth Amendment. And I heard Odets give the eulogy at Bromberg's memorial service.
Same man he had named as a communist.
And then it turned out that he named him before the committee.
And Miller, Bromberg, as a result, went bankrupt, broke, ill health, and eventually died.
That's right. That's right. Now, Miller took the opposite position. Miller, and he got in an argument with Ilya Kazan, who had directed his great plays, Death of a Salesman and All My Sons, and Miller said that he would answer the committee's questions as to himself, but he said he didn't want to bring trouble to other people. And he did something that people like people like the Hollywood Ten were unwilling to do. They said, you don't even have the right to ask us about ourselves. Pete Seeger said, you know, I refuse to answer any questions about my politics because you're punishing people because of their beliefs. What I will do is sing you the songs that I sang during those years. And he said, Congressman Walter, I know some great songs from your home county in Pennsylvania, from the coal mining region, which was very important testimony. Miller, on the other hand, conducted himself as though it were a college seminar. You know, they asked him, how come your plays are done in Moscow? He says, I can be no more responsible for who does my plays than General Motors can for who rides in his Cadillacs. But when the time came, he wouldn't give the names. He did, however, you know, there's a lot of backbiting, even among the resistors. He did say that he had been to hell and back and seen the devil, because he had been to Communist Party meetings, and which led Lillian Hellman to say of him, well, if he went to hell, he must have gone as a tourist, because he really wasn't deeply involved in party stuff. But it seems to me there is a lesson to be learned from people like Arthur Miller and Lillian Hellman, her famous line, I will not and cannot cut my conscience to fit the fashions of the times, when they asked her to name the people she had been in the party with, and Seeger, and Lionel Stander, the character actor who got up before the committee and said, you know, I'm here to name a bunch of fanatics who are out to undermine the United States Constitution. And he started naming the members of the committee that were asking the question. And the lesson to me from those people is that it was possible for them to stick to their own code. They resisted, and they prevailed. They came back. They were out in the cold for many years, and they couldn't work, and they were treated as social outcasts. Now, to have been blacklisted is a badge of honor, and I think that lesson makes it more difficult for it ever to happen again, because we have their example to live by. And in Friendly Fascism, you know, you have that section at the end where you talk about what can we do, and you talk about the importance of individual actions and example. I think there's no better instance of that than these characters in Naming Names who went forward and stuck to their code at personal risk. And
Victor, there is one classic case I wish you'd discuss, and that is a very well-known director, Mr. Ilya Kazan. Yeah. And his position in all this.
Okay. Well, Kazan is famous and infamous for his role in this, because he not only named the names before the committee, despite Arthur Miller's attempt to talk him out of it, he also, at the time that he testified, submitted a list of every play he had ever directed. In some cases, he had written some plays, one with a fellow named Art Smith, who was also in the group whom he named. And in each case, he explained why the play was pro-American and why it was anti-communist. And it was a degrading of his own work to do that, since he was a man who had done such important work in the theater and in films. He then took an ad in the New York Times, urging other people to do likewise, in which he argued that the world was divided between totalitarian secrecy and democratic openness. And the way you fought totalitarian secrecy was with openness, no matter how painful that might be to your old friends and supporters. He then went with Bud Schulberg and Lee J. Cobb playing the starring role, and directed On the Waterfront, which, when you think about it, Marlon Brando comes to maturity when he realizes his obligation to think on his fellow hoodlums on the waterfront, and he names names, cooperates with the Waterfront Commission, which is, I see, as a metaphor for the Un-American Activities Committee. Well, Kazan, down through the years, I don't know if you've ever talked to him about it, Cup, but when he goes
he's on talk shows, he's
always asked about it, and he always says, well, I don't want to talk about that. I'm going to write about it. It's too complicated. It takes you got to recreate the whole context to understand what happened. I'm going to write about it in my own time, my own way. But then what he does do is he talks about things like John Dean before the Watergate Committee and other examples of the informer as whistleblower, the informer as patriot, the informer as courageous character.
Now, Victor, it's easy for us to look back now and to say you should not have given those names. But one of the wives, I think, that you quote in the book, so this is a matter of working and getting money and feeding your children, or giving the names. I'm going to give the names every time. It's a matter of practicality and living.
Cutting your conscience to fit the tone of the times is today one of the greatest sins, and it's very widespread throughout the area I know, that is of university life, of academia.
Yeah.
I see my colleagues, younger men, cutting their conscience to fit the latest request for a contract or a grant, whatever the trend. I see them cutting down the minds of their students so they move into harmless little microscopic investigations that don't raise any of the big questions of the day. This is cutting their conscience without naming names. If they name names, they'll quote Milton Friedman, bow and burn incense and on behalf of the free market and things of this type. Go along with this nonsense of the New York Times that our armed forces are so pitiful that we're all in great danger today.
Even Senator Jackson denied that on
television. This changing of conscience is a horrible thing. It's going ahead to vast millions of our population.
The thing is, none of us know what we would do. The thing that interested me about those people is they obviously constituted the least threat to the national security of any group of subversives in the history of this country. They weren't tortured like the people in a man. The pressures on them were their swimming pools and what was being taken away from them. And yet, so many people, decent people, did something which is fundamentally indecent, which is what made me look at that, whereas compared to the serious, to the torture of human beings and the total repression of a society that you write about.
I would like to say this, that at a certain extent, as paradoxical as it may seem, it's almost the same thing. I mean, you cannot, I mean, there was heroism in those who refused to give the names. And there was cowardice in those who did give the names. And it is true that you cannot compare the pressure that was put on them, on the pressure that a man like Alekos of the people in the resistance, not only in Greece, but during the Nazi fascist resistance. My father was also tortured like Alekos at the time of the Nazi fascists. He did not talk, but he was not that severe with those who had talked. And Alekos was not that severe with those who had not behaved like him. You cannot ask all the men to be heroes. You got to be at a certain percentage, at least, a hero. There must be some heroism in you to resist the pressure, which can be it tortured itself. I know that the danger for you, it was to give up, for those, it was to give up the beautiful houses and the swimming pools.
And
but
the
this is your society.
Practice, and the chance to practice,
I mean,
their craft.
You never had the privilege of being put in front of an occasion of real heroism, or real resistance. It is very easy after to say, I would not have done it. I believe I would not have done it, and I think that life has given me occasions. But when life has not given occasion to you to prove that you would not have done, I would go very slowly. I mean, this is a little your American Protestant vision of life.
No,
the
agree.
Evil one side, the bad on the other side.
No, the point that Victor makes in the book is very well taken, which was lost sight of mostly at that time, that the committee doing the investigating was using Hollywood strictly for publicity. They knew they'd get all the publicity, all the big names in show business, and had very little effect
but
on what the nation was writing.
But of course they were despicable, of course. So we all know that. But
I'll tell you your point, though, but this Dalton Trumbo said something that's directly apropos, and I agree with you. He said, made a speech, and he said, those of you who are too young to remember the blacklist, he said, should study it, because there's a lot to be learned. But when you do, don't look for heroes and villains. Don't look for saints and devils, because none of us was without sin. We all were forced to do things we didn't want to do. There were only victims. Now, another member of the Hollywood Ten with him, Albert Malls, who wrote This Gun for Hire and Pride of the Marines, denounced that speech on the following grounds. He said, to say there were only victims is like saying the guard and the prisoner at the concentration camp are both equally victims. And that takes away the meaning of our lives. What do we go to prison for if we're all equally victims? I, in naming names, say that I can't, because I didn't go through it, I can't say who's right in that argument. Only those who went through it have the right to speak to that. But I saw Albert Maltz 2 weeks ago at a meeting of the ACLU in California, and in a public meeting, he raised his hand and he said, I think that you defaulted on your obligation as a historian. It's 30 years later, and you should take a position. You should say who you think is right and who you think is wrong. I think it's a difference of moral style between those two fellows. They both were right. They both resisted when it counted. They both saw the committee as the enemy, which is an important thing to understand, and they both think moral argument is important enough to they exchange about 100 pages of letters.
Yes, but you are forgetting also the others. You are forgetting the crowds. You are forgetting the masses. The what we call in Europe the silent majority, and I call in this book the flock that always says yes and obeys. I mean, those people who betrayed are a reflection of the majority of the people who accept always to be part of the crowd, to who believe in the promises who will not be maintained. I mean, if we want to crucify, and in my moralism, I am on your side, let's crucify more than those who...
We have to say goodbye at this time. We've run out of time, unfortunately. I want to thank three brilliant guests. Oriana Fallaci, the great interviewer and brilliant conversationalist, and the author of a new book called A Man, which tells about her love for Elekos Panagoulis. And this is Victor Navasky. Victor is the editor of The Nation. He's made a magnificent study of blacklisting in the McCarthy era in his book called Naming Names. And Bertram Gross. Bertram has written a book about the growing threat, the creeping threat of fascism in our country called Friendly Fascism. Irv Kupcinet saying goodbye, and see you next week, same time and same place.